Hello, my name is David Faure and I work for KDAB. In this video, I would like to show you how to write a custom widget. You will have to write a custom widget whenever the widgets provided by Qt don't suit your needs. As you might have seen in the previous videos in this series, you can change the appearance of the widgets provided by Qt. But in some cases, you might want a widget that has nothing to do with what Qt provides. Let's say you want a thermometer that shows the current temperature. It's not just changing the appearance of an existing widget, it's a complete new one. In this example here, what I've picked as a custom widget is a toggle switch. You could argue that this is just a rendering for a checkbox, but because we also want checkboxes in this application, and also because the API for checkboxes doesn't completely suit this, like there is no tree state option for a toggle, let's just make a separate widget for a toggle switch. So how do we do that? It's actually quite easy. We just have to remember a number of steps and make sure we go through all of them. First thing to do is to choose a base class. The most common one is going to be QWidget. A QWidget is nothing. It's a gray box. So we can use that as the basis and define our own painting and event handling on top. As the user of that toggle switch, we will want a number of public methods. That's the trivial stuff. We want a setter, we want a getter for the checked state. We can also define a property for that checked state. This integrates better with Qt Designer and scripting languages, anything that might use properties. It could be convenient to have a toggle, which is simply set checked of the negation of the current value. We need it anyway because that's what happens when clicking, and we might as well make it public in case someone wants it. As the user of that widget, we will be interested in signals as well. What I've done here is to define two signals, one called checked, which is emitted when the user changes the value. And it's also sometimes useful to have a signal that is emitted whenever the user or the program changes the value, and I called it toggled. I actually didn't come up with these names. I've used the names from QtCheckbox. Always a good idea to have a look at what's already done to be consistent and to benefit from the experience of the Qt developers. Why do we need both? Well, sometimes you might connect toggled to something that, you know, updates on screen, whatever, depends on the value of the checkbox. And then you load initial settings from a config file and you want those settings to be applied. It's convenient if the signal is emitted so that the rendering that depends on it is updated. So it's useful to have both checked and toggled. Okay, now the next thing that we are going to need is to define the size of our widget. If you don't re-implement size hint, then you get the default size for a widget, which I believe is 100 by 30. It's quite small, definitely not what we want. So we are going to re-implement size hint and simply set a size. In this case, because it's a widget that doesn't show variable contents. I didn't put text into it like your checkbox. I made it very simple. The text is a label. It's a separate widget. So the size of that toggle switch is fixed. I measured in the mockup from the designer that he wanted 26 pixels high. And then we can calculate, because we want the toggle to be a circle, we can calculate how much the width should be. And that's the size of our widget. All right. We can have a look at the implementation of the other methods. IsChecked is trivial, toggle is trivial. SetChecked is interesting. It's always a good idea to compare the new value with the existing one and not do anything if it's the same. Well, first we save a few cycles, but also if we connect two widgets together and they both react to the other, we would get an infinite loop otherwise. So it's important in a setter to say, if I have nothing to do, do nothing. And then if we do change the value, record the new value, emit the toggle signal, and call update. Now, what does update do? It will schedule a paint event. So this means, yes, I want the widget to be repainted, but not right away. And that's quite useful because if you have a number of setters and the user of the application, the code that uses the application does set checked, set the color, set the value, set whatever, a number of setters, you don't want the widget to repaint itself every time. So what will happen is that update will post a paint event into the queue of events. And then when you call the next setter and it calls update again, it will see that there is already an update event being posted to the queue and it will not post a new one. It's enough to repaint just once at the end when we are done with making all the changes and we go back to the event loop. Okay, so the widget is going to be repainted, and that's where it gets interesting. The paint event is the virtual method that is called for any widget when it should paint itself on the screen. And the first thing you always want to do in a paint event is to create a QPainter. And of course, you tell the painter, I'm painting this widget. Don't ever put the painter as a member variable. You're not supposed to use it like that. It will mess up everything. You have to create it as a local variable in the paint event. Because we are going to do rounds, round rectangles, you want to enable anti-aliasing. Otherwise, it will look like stairs, quite ugly. And now we can do the whole logic for the colors. In this case, we want many things like the default colors. We want different colors when the mouse is over the widget, then we get a nice gradient. If I press the mouse, then we might see different colors and all those kind of things. And also when it's under the mouse or if it's not under the mouse, like this effect here. So this is done by these conditions here. And in the second video of this series, I showed you how to write a widget style for the common widgets coming from Qt. And what we did was to create a class called color repository, which holds all of our colors. That's quite nice because when we do custom widgets, we can pick into these colors as well and share them with the widget style. So we can say here, the outline of the toggle switch is the same as the outline of a disabled button. And we call the same method for both. That's what we do here. Okay, and once we are done with pen and brush, we can actually draw the rounded rectangle. What I'm doing until now is simply the overall shape of the widget. Now we can draw what we call the handle. It's the little circle that goes left or right. We simply reduce the size of the rectangle we're working on, set it to be a square. The rectangle itself is a square, which means we get a circle inside of it. And if it's checked, we move it to the right. And we actually want different colors. That's another thing that's part of the style that the designer decided here. If it's checked, then it will have a certain gradient. And if it's not checked, it will have different colors. And we draw the circle with the draw ellipse method. And we have done the painting for that custom widget. So it is overall quite simple. Instead of built-in widgets calling into the style and we have to re-implement things in the style, that's in video 2, what we do here is directly do the painting in the paint event method of the widget. So we have a widget that is usable by the rest of the program. It can paint itself. What's missing is user interaction. What happens when I click on it? To be able to implement that, we will have to re-implement the mouse press event and the mouse release event. A click is actually press followed by release. So what happens when pressing is that, well, first we check that it's the left button. We don't really care for a right click or any other kind of button. And we remember with this member variable that we have clicked on the button. And then in the mouse release, if we clicked on the button, then we will toggle it. Why do we do this? It's actually good practice with buttons and similar widgets that to make it react as a click, you have to click onto it and release into it. If you were to click on one button and release outside on another, then nothing should happen. For people who move the mouse in weird ways, it's actually a way to cancel a click. You click somewhere, hold the mouse, and then you realize, no, I didn't want to click. You can just release it outside. And interestingly, it didn't work here. It actually gets the release event. Okay, it's more the case where you press somewhere and release on another widget, then it shouldn't actually change. And that's what happens here. I click here, release here. Okay, it doesn't move. So in the mouse release event, we say toggle, which will change the value. And then we can emit the checked signal, which is only emitted when the user made the change and not in all cases like the toggle signal here. And that's it for the mouse handling. Similarly, if we want to be able to press the space bar on a button, I need to give it focus here. And then when I press the space bar, it will toggle. We can do this easily by re-implementing key press event, check the key, and if it's the space key, then same as here, toggle and emit checked. And for any other key, we call event ignore so that the key event will propagate up to the parent. And that's actually quite convenient if we want to be able to press enter and it should propagate up to the queue dialog and it will close the dialog. If I didn't do that, then the event would be supposed to be eaten by the toggle switch or supposed to be handled, and then it wouldn't propagate up and return wouldn't work. Okay, so that's how you can implement custom widgets. I hope you have fun with that. You can do all sorts of things. Again, if you haven't seen this series, for the built-in widgets, you don't do that. You don't re-implement the whole widget. You simply implement the widget style. And that's what you can see in video 2 of the series. If I went too fast, take the time to read the code. You can see the link in the description. Or you can book a QtWidgets training from KDAB, because in that training, we have a whole section on custom widgets and a number of exercises where you can train yourself to actually do this. I hope you enjoyed this series, and I hope you subscribe to the KDAB TV channel for more videos from us. Cheers!